Thank you very much. I do say I go through slides very quickly, so put your seatbelts on. First place, 1967 was the first year I closed a water balance on a water ride. It was a chemical plant. So I've been kind of doing some of this for a whole bunch of years. What I want to do today is take you where have you been and where can we go? Without further ado, there we go. A basic concept I think is very important that we often miss, and that is the difference between use and consumption. We often, particularly when we get to water reuse, a lot of that water gets used, but it gets used consumptively. So it's moving out of the water world into the atmospheric world at some point. Keep that in mind as we go through here. That will be a concept I'll talk about. Here's showing kind of estimates for the United States, how much water gets used by each of these sectors, how much of it is consumed. It makes a lot of difference on where you want to go with your conservation programs. That's the point. Also, look at the water stress map of the world. There is a latitude that runs right here that has a lot of red in it. And you notice a whole bunch of the United States is in that area. Who would have thought that Atlanta, Georgia would have water problems? Who would have thought that water efficiency became a major goal in New York City? So with that in mind, let's start taking a look at some other things that are happening out here. With that future of water, many areas in the state of the United States are having actually super declines in groundwater availability. Map showing where some of these problems are. And it's not just the West, we got the whole East Coast involved there. You even have areas around the Great Lakes that are involved in that. We have problems galore coming. The other thing we have going is that our day of dam building, a day of getting our conventional water resources, is basically coming to an end, and yet our populations continue to grow. Interesting situations are occurring, and we need to be able to take a look at it. By the way, comment on reservoirs. Since I'm here, right by Lake Mead, the average gross evaporation from Lake Mead is a billion, that's bees and boy, billion gallons of water a day. I am from Texas. If you take all the Texas reservoirs and put them together, 7 to 8 billion gallons a day gets evaporated. Total municipal use by all cities in the state of Texas is 4 billion gallons. Just put that in your hat and keep it cooking. It's important, and I guess as we go through and look at where we need to be. And so is conservation working? You know, is it doing us any good? Well, this is just a basic, here's how we use water in the United States. 1980 was a watershed year, literally. It was a year that the amount of water being used in the United States began to level off. And we have come a whole long way for a number of different reasons. Here is a graph showing manufacturing output in the United States and manufacturing water use. Yes, manufacturing output is going up, and you will see a slide later on how that relates to the number of people working. Why was this happen? EPA passed the Clean Water Act. I was working in industry as a chemical engineer before we started this, and it made a huge difference. All of a sudden, they had to treat that wastewater before they could dump it. It cost them money. Wow, did a change occur on that. And on the municipal side, here, since I am from Texas, I put the Texas data in here too, but here is the national data. For the United States and for Texas, you notice this was a major drought year, this was a major drought year, this was a kind of intermediate drought year. We didn't get 2011 on here, it would have been back up here. But it's working. Water use per capita is going down in the United States and will continue to go down. Look at New York City, it's cut its water use by more than half. Wow, a lot of good things are happening. Happening for a lot of reasons, and you are a lot of the reason that it's happening. We're also getting into a whole different way of looking at water. We're getting into looking at water from the details of how the energy people have been looking at energy use for 20 years. We have a benchmarking information. This is a very different kind of benchmark. This is a study done in the state of Texas. These utilities are required to report it brings your water use down into single family, multifamily, and the ICI includes industrial, commercial, and institutional. In some cities, it's not very important. In Houston and in Corpus Christi, it's over half the water use for industrial and social. Where have your programs been focused? In most of us have focused on this area. But look at this area here. It's over half water use. Yeah, it's a lot more complicated. It's scary if you don't have a technical background. And it's necessary as we move forward in the areas of water efficiency. Just to something to keep going. And here is something that's actually good for me. Once you start doing these benchmarking type studies, you will start noticing that just a few of your water users in that sector are the ones that you really need to have to focus on. This is building water use, and this is gallons per square foot per year. Boy, I'm telling you, if I'm running a water efficiency program, I'm looking at the guys in this area first off and seeing what I can get out of it. This happens to be elementary schools in Texas. This happens to be light industry in Florida. Look at those guys out there. So we need to get the real data to find out who we need to talk to in our water efficiency program. We have a lot of opportunity there. Again, this just reinforces it. This is EPA, Energy Star Portfolio Manager, which now has a water function in it. It is extremely important that that be saved as in the political arena, as we know, and goes forward. But again, you don't want to be one of these guys out here on these things. But if you're running a program, you know which ones you need to go talk to first. How much water do we use outside? That always gets asked. I'm going to show you a lot of stuff that you may never see before. This is a study, this is part of the Haseman-Sawyer study that was done, showing that in the commercial and institutional sector, somewhere between, say, 25 and 30% of the water use in that sector is used for landscape irrigation in Phoenix, Arizona. Why do I put that in there? That is one of the driest places out there. It means that if you're in New York City, you're going to use a lot less for landscape irrigation. This is a residential end use study. This is indoor use. 58.6 gallons per capita per day. This is a graph from USGS showing residential per capita use across the United States. You'll notice out here we have Washington, Arizona, Utah, Idaho, Nevada, Oregon. You get the Wyoming. I mean, you get the idea. Far west. If you take that 60 gallons per person per day as your kind of base number for indoor use, you end up with a very interesting graph that says the guys that are in green use somewhere between 0 and 20% of their total use for landscape irrigation. These guys are using 30 to 45%, and look where the high water users are, over 45% of their total single family residential uses for landscape irrigation. You start looking at it like that, you start really seeing where we focus. I dare say, if you're sitting here in Maine, you probably are not going to get a lot out of a landscape water conservation program, but you can get a whole lot out of making sure the buildings are properly retrofitted. Okay, that's residential. Here's just a quick look at our TPCD. 145 gallons per person per day is the average in the United States. You work it out, and it comes out to be 58.6 indoors and 29.4 outdoors. If you assume that institutional is and commercial, you notice how I left the industrial out of this. The industrial has almost no landscape irrigation. I just haven't seen much landscape going on in Detroit lately. You end up with the commercial use for landscape irrigation being about 8.6 GPCD. That comes out to be 38 GPCD. Remember that 38, okay? Because I'll show you some other things that help focus on where some of the things are we need to do. Is it working? First of all, I want to show you. This is a fabulous graph put together by the Pacific Institute on water use and GDPCD. Gross domestic product, excuse me. We had that watershed epiphany called called the Clean Water Act. And it primarily is hit from the biggest withdrawers of water out there are, this is withdrawal, not consumption, power plants and irrigation. Irrigation is basically, we're not adding new land to irrigation out there. We're getting more efficient there. And power companies are doing a lot of things differently. That's a big user on that. But let's look at some of these other things. Let's just look at some of the future out here. Right now, most of our power is generated by nuclear, coal, and natural gas, which all use around, there's a huge range out here, but say 0.4 gallons are consumed, not withdrawn, consumed per kilowatt hour. Look at some of our new stuff, solar voltaic, the combined cycle plants. Since most of our new power plants are going in that are using a fossil fuel or using natural gas in the combined cycle thing, more thermodynamics than you want to get into. How many of you have had a course in thermo here? You're the far and few between. How many of you love thermo? Okay, I'm going to hand up on it too. One of my favorite ones. Yeah, we got to know for engineers. I know them. And Fred probably knows more thermo than I do. So, but here's what's happening on growth of power industry. This is just a cameo of what we're going to look at. If you take a look at how it's generated, this is commercial, residential, industrial. This is total kilowatt hours, trillions of kilowatt hours that are going to be used out here in the future. Here's how this graph looks. If we keep on with exactly what we're doing in 2017, you'll have 144 billion gallons of water being withdrawn every day, and 5.1 billion being consumed in this industry. If we just continue with going to the combined cycle facilities, you get here, and if we combine this, and the best we can do, and to the renewables, you get water use down in this level. A lot lower than where we are now. There's a huge potential out there. Residential, let's take a look at that. This is indoor use. This was a study that was presented here last time. We're here. We can get to here, he says, just by the fixtures and stuff. We've got a lot more than we can do. Here's the United States population growth. Here is where we are. This is current use. If we just keep using like that, we're going to go from, this is indoor residential use. 19 billion gallons compared to the 45 billion gallons used in the municipal sector. Okay? And you go up to here. If you go and get down to that, what Bill DiIorio said in his Water Research Foundation study on residential end use, you get to here. And if you include gray water reuse for toilet flushing, you get to here. Now, are we going to get all the way down to here? Of course not. But we have a lot of potential. And do you notice in all those cases, I did the power plants, I did this, we're using less water than we do now? Okay. Which gets me to how have we come? This is a modification of what John Keller shows, because he does what is the code says on how much efficiency we've done. This is if you take the best in the whole class out there. For instance, on Euros, we go to 100% waterless Euros. Okay, you got the concept there? We've got a lot of ways to go and save a lot of water. So how are we doing on market penetration? Here's some studies here showing market penetration. This is just to meet like the EPAC type stuff. So we've done a lot. But if you look at what we've done with the new modern high efficiency codes that have come out from IAPO, Uniform Plumbing Code, Green Codes, and from the IGCC of ICC, we haven't got a whole lot out there, a lot of potential left. And we also have a lot of, oh my gosh, they don't really do that left. Just think of it, every time one person goes, he hits there and he flushes 4 urinals. I mean, I can show, I have a whole program I do on turkeys. It's turkey time, I call it. It's all this kind of stuff. The other big one out here, leaks. 15% of the water that gets put in your distribution system on average doesn't make it where it should go. That's huge. But if you start looking at the residential end use study, it said 14% of the water used in the residential end use study was lost inside the house through leaks. It's actually, that's the average. The median is down, way down below that, because 5% of the houses account for the greatest part of the leaks. AMI is going to be huge in finding those guys. I can tell you right now, hotels and multifamily are famous for leaking. Does anybody have done multifamily studies and found they have a chance, percentage of leak studies, leak loss there? I know 20 to 30% is fairly common in a lot of multifamily places where guys tend to pay the bills. Here's a point. You put all this together and you come up with the GPCDB at 36 gallons per person per day. 38 gallons per person per day for landscape irrigation. Wait a minute, they're almost equal. They're basically the same because of the chatter of the data. We lose as much water through leaks as we use for all the water we put on our lawns. Whoa, opportunities. Now, just take this visual. 1 in 4 down the drain. With that said, let's do another topic, water reuse. Both on-site and also municipal water reclamation. I have to tell you that we have a tremendous potential there. There are cities all over that are getting into requiring the installation of some forms of on-site capture and reuse of water. The important point is, are there most municipalities of any size are putting in water, reclaimed water systems for their wastewater. Huge potential, but most of these uses are being used consumptively. Yeah. Total use, consumption. We got to work those differences out way beyond what we want to talk about here. But the potential's huge. 20 to 30 billion gallons a day range right now. We use 45 billion gallons in the municipal sector. Whoa, a lot of water out there to be tapped. Which gives me the gray water. Inside the home type stuff. Again, here is a gallons per person per day. Toilets use a whole lot of water. We produce a fair amount of gray water from our faucets, our showers, our clothes washers, and bath. A lot more water than is used for flushing toilets. Yeah. Remember the graph I showed you? If you didn't put that in, you'd have significant reduction in capital use. So a lot of things to think about there, but you can't get too far down the road without thinking about dollars. I love this graph. Janice Beecher has put this together. This is water and wastewater utility inflation rate. Here's natural gas going down. Electricity is basically leveled off in cost in the United States. This is going to have a huge impact on where we get to and all this stuff. I can guarantee you that that may be one of your best water conservation drivers you have out there. How many of you have had a decrease in your water utility in the last 5 years? You actually had a decrease? How many had an increase? How many had an increase? Okay, yeah. You get the idea. So how do we range on price? Here's the United States. This is Black and Beach Study 2016, $10 per 1,000 gallons of water and wastewater combined. Anybody want to go to Germany where it's 24, or to Denmark where it's $40 per 1,000 gallons combined? Current? Future, United States. Okay, with that said, here's the, you gotta get into toiletology in these things, and here you go. Here's what it's gonna mean. It means if you have a 5 gallon flush toilet, it costs you a little over a nickel to flush right now, on the average. It's gonna cost you almost 20 cents to flush 20 years from now. Yeah.
Go flush
it. I'm telling you what, now that you're flush with that information, I'll continue. I'm going to use a Texas example. So what does this mean? How does water conservation and reuse cost and importance compare to other sources of water? The Texas Water Development Board has done a significantly detailed study on all this. And here's some things. The urban environment, as in urban and industrial, that's where water use is going in the future. You see where ag is going. It's going down. Right now, it's about 55% of total use is going to go down. The other is going to dominate. Here's an interesting one. You notice this yellow line going down, that's the existing supplies of what we have. And this is where we're going out here. We're silting up reservoirs and we're overdrafting aquifers. conventional existing supplies going down. So they said, well, let's go out and have identified 26 reservoirs. Whew, a bunch. And a whole and desal and everything else. We still don't get where we need to be, and here's what with conservation and reuse we do. On cost, there's the way the breakdown is. Half the new supply in Texas will come from conservation, reuse, and that kind of thing. The dollars per thousand gallons, here's all the others, here's conservation, reuse, drought management, kind of stuff. It is the least cost of the dollars per thousand gallons. And on capital cost, we get half the supply with only 12% of the capital cost. That you could take to the bank, which gets me down to that. With that said, let's take a quick look at the future. Here we are on total withdrawals in the world. You notice we stick out like a big red sore thumb. Mm-hmm. Here's how much water gets used in other countries. The middle that I have in kind of the tan bars, I think at our standard of living, it is very comparable to Norway or France or Germany. They use half, a third of the water we do per capita in their municipalities. We've got a lot of things to learn. We have big data coming on. Who knows what this is going to be? This is a whole new world for us. A new world. I don't know where we're going to get to on that. I can just tell you it's going to be huge. Here's what's happening in manufacturing. Again, manufacturing output is going up. This is the 2008 downturn. Here is employment in manufacturing. Can anybody tell me what happened around the early 80s that really changed things in manufacturing? Can you say robots? Can you say computers? Can you say big data? That's the impact it's had there. I say we're going to have the same impact on how we do water management as that. Which gives me to here. We need to keep on doing this kind of thing. Another reason you can read yourself. We need to get that next bunch of people that are going to be doing this work training. All of you fondly remember your water efficiency 101 course you took in college, right? It didn't exist. It still doesn't exist in most places. Huge opportunities for research in all these areas. Wow, we've got a lot of way to go there. We need to network, establish other things. We need to properly project the future of water. And the two of the people I'm going to use for their pet things, porcupine effect. Look, these are real projections down here from the studies. What did they miss it because they didn't include conservation? We have a long way to go. If we don't get there, we end up looking like this. You don't want to be there. And by the way, yes, but we can use less water 50 years from now than we are now. We're putting all these in. It's going to require your effort. And just remember, you guys are the guys on the front line. I turned 74 on my next birthday. I'm not going to be going much longer. But there it is. You guys have a lot of ways to go on here, and all I can say is have fun, and do you have any questions? I'm going to tell you, I finished that with 8 seconds to spare. Okay, comments?